गुड मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग।
देखो
and just right up. Use the microphone or you can use that one or whatever อันนั้นก็ได้ค่ะอันนั้นน่าจะไม่หอนหรือเปล่าเอออันนี้ค่ะโอเค
Okay, good morning from Bangkok, Thailand, and welcome to our second language assessment webinar series. Whether you are joining us virtually or on site in person, we would like to extend our warmest welcome to each of you. Today marks the beginning of our series with a focus on fundamental of second language assessment. And this session aims to provide a fundamental understanding of language testing principles, exploring various test types, their purposes, and their significance. Your participation is greatly valued today, and we hope to see more participants coming along. So if you haven't tagged your friend for this talk, please do so. And we will kindly request your feedback toward the end of the session. And your insights will help us enhance our offerings for webinar in the future. Before we delve into the main content today, we have the honor to welcome our director, Associate Professor Dr. Supakorn Poojareunsin, the Director of the Language Institute, Thammasat University, who will share a few words with us and to welcome every each one of you to today's talk.
Thank you, Dr. Suchada. Welcome all of us. Now, welcome all of you to our hybrid session on fundamentals considerations in second language assessment. Right. So today, you know, we are very lucky to have Dr. Shin San Yang, right, from Indiana University to share with us new knowledge, actually, you know, some fundamental concepts in language assessment, right? So you are going to be familiarized with fundamental concepts, core principles, right, and different types of language assessment. We hope that you can apply those to your language teaching, right? Actually, Dr. Shin have been friends with Litu for years, right? He has contributed a lot to many language testing projects that we have had, like TUGET standard setting, right? That's the main thing that he has helped us, okay? So I am quite sure that you are going to broaden your horizons from his session. And actually, you know, please note that on Sunday, the 26th, right? He's going to give two more talks, right, all day, right, from in the morning and in the afternoon. So don't miss out on those talks, right? So thank you very much, Dr. Shin, and I hope you enjoy his talk today. Thank you, ครับ.
Your turn.
Yeah. So thank you, Director, for those inspiring words. And without further delay, let us extend our warm welcome to our speaker, Dr. San Yang Shin. Dr. San Yang Shin is from Indiana University. He's an associate professor in the Department of Second Language Studies. He received his PhD in Applied Linguistics with a focus on language assessment from UCLA. His research interests include authenticity in language assessment, L2 pragmatics assessment, standard setting, and classroom-based language assessment in interactive forms. His work has been published in numerous journals and book chapters, and he has been invited for lectures and workshops on second language assessment in several countries. Now I would like to invite Dr. San Yang Shin to take the stage and share his insights with us. Please welcome Associate Professor Sun Yongxin.
So, thank you so much for nice introductions, Ajahn Supakorn and Chara. It is always my great pleasure to be at LITU and then share my research and then some fundamental issues in language assessment. So let's take a look at the overview of my talk today. So my talk is about the fundamental considerations in language assessment. So this talk is for people who have very little or no knowledge in language assessment. So it kind of give you some foundation in language assessment. And then the following Sunday, next Sunday, I'm going to talk about what are some current issues in assessing language in both research and practices. And then the following afternoon, and then we're going to talk about what are the process we have to follow to set the CUT scores for our test. So this is kind of one of my first talk in the series in language assessment. So today we're going to talk about first limitation in assessment in general. So we're trying to assess the language ability or skill or knowledge which is not directly observable. So inevitably we have many limitations. So it is very important to know what limitations we're facing and how can we minimize those limitations for better understanding of our language assessment we're trying to measure. And then we need to come up with the numbers to understand the level of language abilities. And then the question is, what kind of numbers we can assign to the students' linguistic performance? So we're going to talk about the different measurement scales. And then we're going to talk about why we are measuring language assessment. You know, the language assessment is not really a popular course among the many graduate students because whenever they see the word assessment, there's tend to associate with the math and statistics, right? But that's not always the case. We need to think about why we assess language abilities of our students and what purpose we are trying to achieve by assigning these numbers to our students' language behaviors. So we're going to talk about how the reason for assessing students can be related to the way we assess and what we measure, which is related to the following topic, what we're trying to measure, which is about construct language assessment. And then we're going to move on to the next stage. So if you're clear about why we measure and what we measure, and then the next question is, how do we measure them? So I'll briefly talk about some steps that we need to take to develop the test specifications. And then once we got all these students' responses to our task, the final step is to analyze the numbers, their scores. So I'm gonna walk you through the descriptive statistics and then correlations. And then finally, I will talk a little bit more about the how do we use those number statistics to evaluate our language test materials. So I will briefly talk about different item statistics and then different like validation method. So this is what we're going to talk about today. Okay, now let's first talk about the terminologies first, the key terminology we use in language assessment. The first one is assessment, right? So anything we assess kind of in a systematic in a substantive way, we can call it assessment, right? So we observe students' language behaviors following some explicit rules and procedures. And then our observation is based on either previous research or theory. We could call it assessment. But assessment is a slightly different from the measurement, which is a little bit narrower definition of assessment. In a measurement, we need to assign numbers to our observations. So what that means, like, there's some non-measurement assessment, right? So if you do systematic classroom observations without assigning any numbers, that activity can be called assessment, but not measurement. So if you claim that you're doing measurement, we always assign numbers to our observation of a language behaviors. And then the test is the smallest concept in among these three terminologies. So a test is a type of measurement. So we have to assign numbers to the students' behaviors. And then what makes tests different from measurement is that we use very specific tasks to elicit some target language behaviors. So for example, you observe students' language behavior in the classroom, and using some kind of a criteria rubrics, we could measure their overall performance from 5-4, like Likert scale. 5 is highest and 1 is lowest. But we do not really give the specific tests to elicit specific language behaviors. But if you claim that you're doing a test, we give specific task students to elicit a certain kind of a target language behavior. So for example, if you want to know how well our students use the past tense in English, you might specifically ask questions to elicit their control of the past tense in English. So for example, you could ask like, so what did you do last weekend? Right. We're not really particularly interested about what they did on weekend, but we want to know how well they can use the verb in the past tense in English, right? So this kind of a test, we called it oral proficiency interview, OPI, is a really good example of a language test. We ask questions to elicit certain kind of linguistic functions and forms, right? And then we assign that their behaviors, their performance on the OPI to the numbers using our rating rubrics. So the OPI is a good example of a test. So tests can be measurement and assessment. But then evaluation is a slightly different from these three terminology. It's about the way we use these assessment, measurement, and test results. So we often make decisions about them. So we hope that our evaluations or decisions about students can bring about some positive consequences to both each individual student and the language programs, right? So this is kind of a big picture of these three different terminologies. So one thing that I want to bring your attention to these differences in terminology is that the reason why we assessing students, measuring test students, is to make some evaluations, kind of value judgment. Usually that lead to some specific decisions about them. It could be either admission or certifications or some diagnostic, but we hope that we can bring about positive consequences for all stakeholders. So this is the way we make use of our test scores. So the step one is observation. So we observe students' language behaviors, and then we convert their behaviors based on observations to the test scores, the numbers, right? And that link is about the reliability. So we observe students' language behaviors over time or across different tasks. So if you assume that our language ability is stable over time or across different tasks, our scores should be consistent across different tasks over time, right? So if you can demonstrate that our test scores are consistent over time or across different tasks, we could say that our test is reliable. So reliability is simply about the consistency of our test scores. And the next step is, so we don't just stop at, you know, assigning the scores to the students, right? We make interpretations or inferences about their language abilities or skill knowledge based on their test scores. So, for example, we want to make interpretations about their grammatical knowledge in English. And then if our test scores can be good evidence of their grammatical knowledge, we could argue that our test is valid for such interpretations, right? So if, let's say if we have a kind of good evidence for that claim, right? And then we can say that our interpretation is valid. And the next step is we don't just stop at the interpretation, right? We say that, yeah, this student has a high grammatical knowledge or pragmatic knowledge in English, but we make do something about that, our interpretations, right? That decision is usually either admissions or certifications or overall proficiency. So we make some decisions. So actually at this link, we need to, we need to set the cut points to make such decisions, right? So we could say above certain point, you pass, above certain point below, you fail, or certify, non-certify, master, non-master, or it could be level 3, 2, 1, CFR, B2, A1, whatever. We necessarily set the some cut points to make such decisions. So at this link, we have to show that our cut scores is a reliably validly set up, right? So that could be very important validity evidence. So for example, if our cut point is too low, that means our bar is too low, right? Then we might have a lot of false positive errors, right? So those students who fail end up passing the test because our cut point is too low. And opposite case is like when you set the cut point is really high, then it's very difficult for most of students to pass the test, although they should have passed the test, then we'll have a lot of false negative errors, right? So setting the cut point appropriately is very important to really help us to make good decisions about test taker. And then let's assume that we make interpretations, decisions in a valid way. And we hope that those kind of decisions we make about students bring about some positive consequences for all stakeholders involved. So when you make a really good decisions and then students really, you know, study for the test and they improve their language learning skills or abilities in general, that would be an example of a good consequences, right? And then we have to actually collect that evidence as additional validity evidence. Okay, so this is kind of a general step we developed our language assessment. Okay. Oh, I received some text message in the chat box. She said she cannot hear the sound clearly. There are any technical problems. I think something's going on we have to fix right now. Yeah, it's for most people here. I think I need to change the microphone setup. Hello, can you hear me better? It's a little bit echoing though, but. Okay, the Zoom participants. Oh, they said it sounds better. Okay, they can hear me better. Okay. Okay, so I think that's what happened. We adjusted the audio settings. So yeah, if you still cannot hear me well, please leave your comments in the chat box so we could adjust it accordingly. Okay, so. Okay, so now let's move on to limitations of measurement. So As I said in the beginning of the talk, we are trying to measure language abilities or knowledge of skills which are not directly observable. So it's inevitable we having some limitations in our language assessment, right? And let's briefly talk about what limitations we are going to face when you try to measure some kind of psychological traits like language abilities. The first limitation would be under specifications. So, which means that there's so many factors other than language abilities affect the student's test performance, right? It could be their chance or their some level of a test anxiety, or if it's possible that task is not appropriately constructed, instructions are not clear. So there are so many factors affecting their scores. So it's almost impossible to specify all these kind of what you call the measurement errors, sources of measurement errors. But our job is as a language tester or teacher to minimize those kind of unwanted sources of score variance, right? So theoretically, it's impossible to specify the factors affecting the test performance. But as a tester or teacher, language teacher, we have to try our best to minimize any identifiable sources of measurement errors, right? So for example, we could reduce their guessing factor. So then if you have to use your multiple choice tests, you could, you know, increase the number of the options. That's one possibility. And then if you're really concerned about guessing factor, then you could just, you know, switch your test format to more open-ended style of test. And then make sure that a student's test anxiety level is low, and then, you know, they have really kind of good conditions to take the test. So for example, if you have a listening test, we try to minimize any kind of background noise. So that's kind of a one way to minimize those kind of sources of measurement errors. And the next limitation is indirectness, right? So the mental attributes like, you know, language abilities is only inferred from the observation of performance. So our measures are necessarily indirect indicators of the abilities we want to measure. So people might think that, yeah, the speaking tests or writing tests is a more direct indicators of their abilities. But still, we cannot see their speaking or writing abilities directly, right? So make sure that our measures are necessarily indirect indicators. So we cannot claim that our test is like direct measures of abilities because we cannot see them directly. Okay. And then incompleteness, or some people call it sampling error. So we cannot really collect samples of individuals' total language performance, right? The standardized tests like IELTS or TOEFL or TOEIC, they're pretty long, like a 4 or 3 hour long test. But that's like tiny, you know, the samples of our language test takers' total performance. Right? We cannot, you know, follow through them for like 24 hours. That's not possible. So our language samples we collect from the students is incomplete, right? And then the samples of a group performance. So if you want to interpret our test scores using the norm, but that no group cannot be the total populations, right? So those norm groups is also the samples of a group performance. So our interpretation of a test scores in terms of how well the norm group perform on the same test can also be limited incomplete. Samples from a content domain. So yeah, take a look at these, like the big tests like IELTS and then TOEFL. So for example, like a TOEFL in the reading sections, they only have four passages, right? So those four passages can never be the full representation of the academic content that students will face in the real life world, right? So the samples can also be quite limited. So this limitation we call incompleteness is not easy to avoid. But as a tester or language teacher, what can you do to minimize these incompleteness limitations? Well, you have to make sure that our language samples are really representative. So what you can do is you could do some kind of needs analysis and task analysis, and then you could show that our passages and inputs are really representative. It's covered a wide range of topics and vocabulary and grammatical structures. So you may want to do some kind of a corpus analysis of our the task content and then the content domain as well. And then about the norm group, right? So norm group also really representative. So we have to show that our norm group is, you know, covers the wide range of test takers in terms of their proficiency levels and then L1 backgrounds and other personal attributes. Okay. And then in precision. So this is about the number of a task or scale points. So to increase the precision of our measurements, we need to increase the scale points. So for example, let's say if you want to measure a person's height, and then let's say you have a 1 yardstick with only have a unit of a meter versus yardstick with the units of a centimeter, which yardstick would you use to measure your height? Definitely the second one, right? The yardstick with the centimeter units. You could actually more precisely measure a height. So same principle can be applied to language assessment too. So compare that the grammar test with only 10 items versus a grammar test with 100 items. Which grammar test do you think is provide more precise information about the grammatical knowledge? Definitely the second one, right? So basically the more items, the more scale points you have, the more precise your test will be. But then we shouldn't forget that the practicality, right? We don't want a students like, you know, die or get seriously tired by taking our test. So we kind of limit it for that reason, right? So our tests can always be imprecision to some degree. Okay. And then we have to also need to be concerned about the comparability of tasks or scale points. If one item or task is too easy or too difficult, we cannot get the accurate understanding of the student's language abilities, right? So we have to make sure that the items or tasks are at the appropriate level of a difficulty. And then subjectivity, right? So language assessment are subjective in nearly all aspects. So test developers, right? When you design a test, we make some very subjective decisions on the test content, test format, right? And then for the test takers, while they're taking a test, they're making subjective judgment on each item or task. And then test users, sometimes they choose the cut points in some kind of arbitrary manner. So for example, in the United States, they usually choose like a TOEFL score 80 as a cut point for admission decisions for international undergraduate students who want to come to United States for their undergraduate studies. But that cut point at 80 is pretty arbitrary. Some schools is like some really good university, like Ivy League school, their cut points like 100, right? So those kind of decisions on the cut point is a very subjective decisions. So this subjectivity cannot be also avoided in kind of a language assessment. So then how do we minimize such subjectivity as a test developer? So it should be really teamwork, right? So we should really solely depend on small number of people's decisions, right? So we do pilot testing and see how students perform on the tests we develop. And then based on those results, we revise or drop some bad items, make sure that all the test items are not really biased for or against a certain group of students, right? And then for test takers, so this is like subjectivity is inevitable, but by providing the more items, more multiple tasks, we can kind of minimize those kind of subjectivity. And then test users, right? They have to make a very informed decisions about the use of a test, right? So we need to educate them. So that's kind of a related to issue of a language assessment literacy. So that's part of our teachers and language testers' job to help them to make a very informed decisions about our test. Relativeness. So we don't really have an absolute reference point. So when you want to interpret our test scores, we have to use either our norm group. If we do that, our tests will become norm reference tests. And if you use some kind of external criteria to make sense of a test scores, then our tests will become criterion reference testing. So for example, if you use a CFR levels to interpretate our test scores, then our test scores are criterion reference tests, CRT. And then, but if the test is like IELTS or TOEFL or other tests, the test score is kind of interpreted as your personal score, you know, your relative ranking of a test scores, right? Then that test is called the NRT. But these days, a lot of NRT also want to be called the CRT. So if you go to that website or Cambridge, like IELTS or ETS TOEFL, you may see that the correspondence table. So we could convert their TOEFL IELTS score into the CFR levels, right? So these days, the tests are really kind of becoming hybrid, right? You could know your relative ranking, and also you can interpret your test scores in relation to some external standards or guidelines. But one thing we have to make sure that here, those kind of frames or reference points is all relative, right? We don't really have an absolute reference point. So that's another limitations we encounter when you use our language assessment. Okay, now I'm gonna move on to the reason why we use assessment scores, but before I move on to the next topic, if there are any questions about what I talked about so far, you're free to leave your question in the chat box. Let me quickly check my chat box here. Okay, so I don't see any questions yet. Then I'm gonna move on to the next topic, why we should bother assess our students' language abilities and skills. We need to look at our history first. So the very first like use of a language assessment is identifications, right? So we use a test score to identify a certain group of people, usually for their ethnic identity. So when people physically look alike each other, it's difficult to identify who they are based on their looks, right? So they often use this kind of pronunciation test to identify which group they belong to. So we can make some in-group versus out-group decisions. And the most famous test for achieving such kind of identity purposes is probably the shibboleth. It's from the story from the Old Testament. So there are two groups who are using the same river called the Jordan River. And then there was the kind of a big fight between these two ethnic groups. So the one group who actually control the river want to make sure that their group is only use this Jordan River. So the another ethnic groups was trying to use this river or cross river. They stopped them and asked them to pronounce the word Shibboleth. So the in-group people were able to pronounce as Shibboleth, like as in a ship or sheep, right? That's the kind of alveolar fricative consonants. But the another out-group people pronounce this Shibboleth as Sibboleth, as we pronounce like a C or saw, or, you know, it's kind of a post-alveolar fricatives. So if they pronounce as Sibboleth, they'll or identify as an out-group people, and then they receive some kind of a persecutions, right? So this is kind of the first use of a language assessment in the history, identifications. We still use this, like, so in certain countries, especially they want to control the immigrations, and then they use this kind of similar language assessment tests for identification purposes only. Okay, and then next, so we make some decisions about the selection appointment, screening for administrative officers test. They call the imperial examinations. So this test was administered in countries like China, Korea, Vietnam. But the, when you look at the subject of the test they had to study for, it's like memorizations of the five Chinese classic canons, and they have to work on the calligraphy. Those are the constructs that were measured in this imperial test. But the main purpose of this test is like, you know, selecting, appointing some qualified administrative officers. So language, it's a little bit hard to be called the language assessment because they also measure non-stick content as well. But the language assessment is kind of a part of it, like especially for the writing, right? Writing skills is a big skills that were tested in this imperial examinations. But the main purpose of this using this kind of test is for selecting some administrative officers. And then for in the modern history, people use language assessment for making some certifications and exigencies in certain professions or course. So they have a more main focus on the understanding literature, culture, and foreign language. And the common test they use was like translation, dictation, and then reading aloud task. So there's another text saying that has a problem with the hearing. Okay. Let me see. Should I adjust the microphone again? Can anybody else hear me well? I switched the microphone. Is it helping better? Can you hear me better? Okay, now, so next is, this is probably the most modern use of language assessment is called the admission test, right? So I think we use TU-GET for making submission decisions, right, for Tamasage University and other institutions, if I'm correct, right? And then we know that IELTS is a really, you know, popular tests in the Thailand and Vietnam and many other Asian countries. And then the TOEFL or PTE academic test is also used for making some admission decisions for English speaking universities. Okay, then. But those are the examples of summative assessment. So we interpret the test scores to make some summative decisions about test takers, like identifications or certifications, permissions, admissions. But these days, people are more concerned about the formative assessment. In other words, we use assessment for learning, not necessarily for all of learning, right? So we use assessment to monitor students' language progress to support their learning. And the dynamic assessment can be viewed as one sort of formative assessment. And then we also talked about assessment as learning, like student-centered assessment. So students learn language abilities by assessing themselves or assessing their peers, right? So in a formative assessment, we are now more focused on how we help the students. So we more emphasizing how assessment can generate the feedback to us enhance learning. But this is kind of a relatively low stake decisions. We're not really focused on reliability to evaluate assessment for learning, for formative assessment. So what are the key principles of formative assessment? So unlike summative assessment, we're trying to create a big picture of learner progress over time. And then we may try with the different strategies or feedback used by teachers and through observation. And then we often work with the students on specific tasks, and we try to give some feedback, and then we review their progress. So in a summative assessment, we are not really allowed to work with the students, right? If you do that, we might call it a cheating, right? We only just proctor the students during the test. But in the formative assessment, we work with the students, right? We see that we can provide a really helpful feedback. And then once they receive feedback, whether they perform better, right? And then we could actually track down their language progress over time, right? So that's kind of a main use of a formative assessment. And there are some key strategies contributing to effective formative assessment, like classroom questioning, comment-only marking, and self and peer assessments. And then formative assessment, use of a summative assessment can be considered the key strategies contributing to effective formative assessment, right? So I think that to successfully use our formative assessment, you have to use a multiple assessment task. And then we have to make sure that the students have some equal voice about their assessment too. And dynamic is also one sort of formative assessment. I'm going to talk a little bit more about dynamic assessment on next Sunday. Okay, now I'm going to switch gear. So far we talked about different possible uses of a language assessment. Now I will switch gears and to talk about what we should measure, right? What we should measure. So that's about the construct. And then to decide on what we need to measure, there are two different ways. One is like kind of a theory-oriented approach. So one approach is like, you know, just refer to some common model of second language abilities. Is that this, you know, Bachman and Palmer, the framework of community language ability is one of them, right? And then you could select this type of language abilities that you is most relevant to your language teaching situations. And another way to decide on the construct is like based on your very careful understanding or observations of the students or language learners' target language performance, right? See how what knowledge abilities are needed to perform some target work in the real world context. But I talk a little bit more about the first approach to identify the construct in your test using these models of language abilities. So here we have a language knowledge, right? And then the language knowledge is interact with the strategic competence. So strategic competence in this framework is the same as the metacognitive strategies. So this metacognitive strategy can be applied to other non-language knowledge as well, right? It could be related to our daily life. So there are three major components in the strategic competence. The first one is goal setting, right? We set the goal to perform our target task, right? So we set the goal. So you decide what you want to do. And once you set the goal, what do you do next? We do appraising, right? You're assessing what you can do, what resources are available, your current situations. And then once you're done with the appraising, what you have, what you can do, and you move on to planning. So careful planning, right? And then the final step will be executing that planning. So the three components in strategic competence is like goal setting, appraising, and then the planning, right? And those are actually interact with the language and knowledge. So what that means is that those kind of metacognitive strategies can compensate for some kind of, you know, weaknesses or lack of language knowledge. So it's important to teach those metacognitive strategies, or if it's possible to assess those metacognitive strategies, because that could be considered as a one aspect of language abilities. Okay, so that was strategic competence here. And then the language knowledge can be broken down into organizational knowledge and pragmatic knowledge. So under organizational knowledge, it could be further broken down into grammatical knowledge and then the textual knowledge. All right. And then in pragmatic knowledge, it could be broken down into functional and social linguistic knowledge. But this terminology, they actually don't nicely correspond with the terms that the pragmaticians use or social linguists use. So I listed more commonly used terms here. So functional knowledge, people might call it pragmatic linguistic knowledge. For social linguistics, some people might call it social pragmatic knowledge. So this is probably more common terms used in the field of pragmatics. Okay, let's tackle this organizational knowledge first. So under grammatical knowledge, although it's called the grammatical knowledge, it includes knowledge of phonology, knowledge of orthography as well. And then vocabulary knowledge is a part of under this grammatical knowledge. So don't be just deceived by the term grammatical knowledge. This knowledge includes beyond the knowledge of a syntax or morphosyntax. And this is like most common knowledge we often measure, right? So we measure those grammatical knowledge using some decontextualized discrete point grammar tests, vocabulary level tests, size tests, or some kind of a reading test, or grammatical judgment test, like dictations. These tests are kind of designed to tap into this grammatical knowledge. This is like really like at the heart of language knowledge, right? Without knowing grammar and vocabulary, you cannot say anything. You can understand what people say, right? So I think still we need to really assess these part of language knowledge, which is grammatical knowledge. And the next one is a textual knowledge. And the textual knowledge can be broken down into cohesion and coherence, which I'll talk a little bit more detail now here. So cohesion is about the flow of a text. And we could achieve cohesion by using appropriate grammatical and lexical linking devices within a text that used to hold the text together and give its meaning. So by using some appropriate synonyms, adverbials, conjunctions, we could achieve cohesion of our text. So it's kind of a how text flow from one sentence to another. So it's kind of similar to, you know, the glue that put all the different parts of furniture together. So cohesion devices is kind of a glue in a text, right? So if you do not use cohesive devices correctly, your text sounds a little choppy and sounds a little monotonous, right? And the flow is kind of a rough, right? So achieve a good cohesion is very important. And coherence is related to cohesion, but it's different. So unlike cohesion, coherence is more about the overall impression of a text, whether the whole text makes sense on the whole. So that's what coherence is about. So it's possible that your text is a very cohesive, but not coherent at all. So it's about, more about the semantic property of a text, right? So semantic is more about the meaning, right? So it's about meaningfulness in the minds of the readers. So it's always interact with the reader's like topical knowledge or background knowledge. So if you're familiar with a certain topic, that text might be coherent to you, but if you do not share the same background knowledge of the text, what the text that the writer or speaker was wrote or talked about, that same sentence may not be coherent to that group of readers or listeners. And how do we achieve coherence in the writing? By using appropriate titles, subtitles, paragraphing, formatting, and logical ordering will help you to achieve a coherence in your writing. So if you like submit your manuscript to a journal, probably the most common comment you might have received about their comment on the coherence, they might say that, yeah, your manuscript's kind of not coherence. What that means, like, there's not good transition from one part of your writing to another part of writing. You may have a good not subheadings or subtitles. The idea is not really flows well, lacks of some logics. So you could achieve the coherence by paying more attention to those features. Okay, so let me talk a little bit more about the cohesion versus coherence here. So take a look at the first sentence. John went to the shops, John bought an ice cream, John ate the ice cream. The first sentence looks a little choppy, right? Monotonous, quite repetitive, right? But to increase the cohesion, what it can do is, can you identify some three different cohesive devices here to make the second sentence sounds more cohesive? The first one you probably noticed is that, using and, right? Using and, which was absent in the previous sentences, right? So conjunctions to join the first and second sentence together is one of the cohesive devices that are used here. And the next one is he, instead of using John repeatedly, the writer replace John with the pronoun he, and then ice cream will become eat, right? And then finally, ellipsis. So he was missing, omitted in the aided here, right? So using these ellipsis conjunction substitutions, you could achieve a high level of a cohesion in your text. But what about coherence? So let's take a look at this video clip that I found on the YouTube. So this, let me give a little bit of background about this video clip. So this is a while ago, this is not a recent video, but you know the Miss Pageant, like Miss America in the contest. So what they did in the past, each candidate received questions, right? And then they were asked to answer to that questions. This kind of a, you know, interview style. So definitely she's a beautiful, and she's Miss South Carolina, and she's American, so she's definitely a native speaker of English. And let's see how coherent her response is. Okay. Let me change the option. So let's watch this.
Recent polls have shown a fifth of Americans can't locate the U.S. on a world map. Why do you think this is?
So the question she received was that a recent poll shows that a fifth of Americans cannot locate the U.S. on the world map. Why do you think that is? A fifth of Americans, which means that 20% of Americans, cannot find United States on the world map. Why? Because they're so ignorant, right? The question is, why they're so ignorant? Why they're such dumb? United States is a big country, right? Why is it 20% Americans cannot find the U.S. on the world map, right? So if you are in these situations, what would you say and how would you say? Like, probably say like, oh yeah, it's so unfortunate, but I think that we have something wrong in our educations. They lack geographical knowledge, blah, blah, blah. So that's kind of expected response, right? But let's see how she handled these questions.
Okay. Recent polls have shown a fifth of Americans can't locate the U.S. on a world map. Why do you think this is?
I personally believe that U.S. Americans are unable to do so because some people out there in our nation don't have maps, and I believe that our education, like such as in South Africa and the Iraq, everywhere like such as, and I believe that they should, our education over here in the U.S. should help the U.S. or should help South Africa and should help the Iraq and the Asian countries, so we will be able to build up our future for our children.
Thank you very much, South Carolina.
Right, so what she says totally irrelevant to the question she has received, right? Why is talking about South Africa, Iraq, and Asian countries? We're really good at, you know, geography, right? So she was totally lost. But you could see that her response is kind of cohesive, though. She was like, such as, so she used some kind of a cohesive devices. But her spoken text is totally incoherent. It's not really meaningful, right? So one thing you could learn from these short video clip is that cohesion and coherence is related, but being cohesive doesn't guarantee that being coherent in a text. Okay, thank you, Miss Carolina. We're gonna move on to the next one. So next one is about, okay, so now we understand the difference between cohesion and the coherence, right? So then how can we assess those like cohesion and cohesiveness? One way is like using this kind called the C test or closed test. So this one is kind of more close to closed test, right? It's a closed test, right? So this kind of test can be used to assess mostly, like, I would say, cohesion in a text. So let's do this task, and then let's try to fill in the blank. We have five blanks here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So do your best to fill in the blank. What are the missing words in each blank? You could type your responses in your chat box if you can. Right. So this kind of a closed test can be either using fixed ratio deletion or rational deletion. So this one is kind of the rational deletion. So if you use a fixed ratio deletion method for closed test, you blank like a word in every fifth or sixth or seventh words. So you randomly delete the words from the text. That's the example of a fixed ratio deletion. But for example, like here, I didn't delete the word using some the equal interval. I just kind of delete the original words based on the level of the guessing the target words by understanding the surrounding text. So yeah, we have a couple of responses here. Okay. It's quite difficult, right? So we also might have different acceptable responses for certain blank. So that's why we use a C-test. So what makes C-test different from the typical closed test? We could provide the first or second letters from the missing word here. So let's see. This is about, you know, the Blackpink concerts, which I think happened last year. So let's see. Blackpink, one of the most popular K-pop girl groups, recently held a concert in Thailand. The concert venue was packed with, right, with the thousands of fans eagerly waiting to see their favorite group perform. So this one is like whether you know the prepositions associated with the word packed with, wait to, right? So this one is like not preposition. This is like the gerund here. The Blackpink. Now we need a verb here. Audience with their charismatic stage presence and stunning performances. Right. So what word would be appropriate in this blank? So we have captivate. Yeah, we have a lot of captivate here. And then welcomed, greeted. The original word in the blank tree was mesmerize. But I think captivate works fine here too. So we have a couple of some acceptable answers here, either captivated or mesmerize. And then the four is a stage presence. And then the fifth one is easy, right? Especially if you know who they are. Jenny, Lisa, Jisoo, Rosé, and then they're all members of Blackpink, right? So if you especially blink, you have no problem answering this correct. Okay, so now I'm gonna move on to some pragmatics. So the pragmatic knowledge is important in the models of second language acquisitions. It's a very important type of language skills and knowledge we need to teach and learn, but it's kind of has been ignored in language assessment, right? So it's really important to know what pragmatics in the first place. So here, Pragmatics is about the understanding the speaker's or writer's intention, because we're more concerned about the meaning as communicated by speaker, interpreted by the listener. So it's kind of a two-way communication, right? You say something, and then you expect that either speaker or writer, I mean, the listener and the reader can understand your intention. And then pragmatics is also study about the contextual meaning. So pragmatics is, if you ask, what is pragmatics? And I would say, how context influence the language. That's what pragmatics is about, right? So it's about how people use language in particular context, and then how the context influence what it says. And then is also the pragmatics about study about how more gets communicated than it is said. So how do you understand the underlying meaning, which we call the implicature, right? How do you understand implicature of specific sentences and utterances? And also how the relative power, social distance, and degree of impositions affect the content of the utterance, right? So this is like what pragmatics is a concern about, they study about. And then let's talk about some details about pragmatics one by one to help you to better understand the pragmatics in general. I know some of you have already, familiar with this, but, just bear with me that, this is like fundamental consideration language assessments. So, if you already know, just be patient with me. This is just like kind of a good refreshing your memory too. So the Grice conversational maxims is a quite important in pragmatics. This is about what maxims you should follow for appropriate conversations between interlocutors. The first maxim is what I call the maxim of equality. And the next one is the maxim of quantity. And third one is the maxim of relevance. And then fifth one is called the maxim of manner. You have to be clear. So what is mean by maxim of equality? It's related to truthfulness. Let's take a look at this conversation here. Should I buy my son this new sports car? This is quite common, conversation between mom and dad in the US, because like in the US, the public transportation is horrible. So you cannot go anywhere without driving a car, right? So usually, in the U.S., you get a driving license at the age of 16. And then, like, when you become 17, like a junior in high school, they usually drive car to school. So, and then the questions here, should I buy my son this new sports car? And B said, I don't know if that's such a good idea. His record isn't so great. So it's kind of, clear, like areas of conversation, right? So speaker B think that the buying his son new sports car is not a good idea because he probably have a bad driving record, right? And then, but compared to this response here, oh, absolutely. He's only totaled two cars since he got his license last year. So look at the response. Oh, absolutely. Right. But when you look at his second response, it's kind of it's opposite, right? Contrasting. Right. So the absolutely is not really you have to buy him a new car. Right. So the speaker B here is flouting or violating the maximum of equality, right? So what he said is not really truthful. That's not what she meant. But by saying, oh, absolutely, and then by something like some opposite fact in the subsequent utterance, he deliberately flouting this maximum of equality. So what kind of functions speaker B can achieve by deliberately flouting this maximum quality? Start being sarcastic, right? So if you violate these maximum quality, you could, you know, tell jokes, or you could sound sarcastic. What about maximum quantity here? You expect it to give you more enough sufficient information in a conversation. So the question, where is the post office? Down the road, about 50 meters past the second lab, versus not far. If somebody said not far, right, you didn't get the enough information about your questions, right? So this example showed that how maximum quantity can be flouted. Maximum relevance, how are you doing school? Not too well, actually. I'm failing two of my classes. So this response does not violate the maximum relevance because speaker B response to the question is relevant to the question. But what about this one? What fine weather we're having lately. So speaker B is deliberately avoiding the topic, right? So that indicates that I don't want to talk about this question. This is kind of, I'm in the some uncomfortable situations, right? And the next one is like, what do you think about the movie? I liked the creative storyline. The ending was really surprised versus it was interestingly done, right? So this response is not really clear enough. And this response violating the maximum of manner. So it is important to satisfy these conversational maxims for efficient conversations, but you could deliberately flout these maxims to tell jokes or to achieve certain kind of speech functions. And then we have to know the different contextual factors affecting the politeness in a conversation. So we have to know that, you know, the use language differently depending on the power difference, social distance, degree of imposition of the content of the utterance, right? So we use language differently, right? When you borrow a book versus when you have to borrow like 100 million baht, right? So these different contextual factors should affect the politeness in the language use. What about the speech act theory? So we have locutionary act, which is about the propositional act, which is about the basic act of utterance. And then elocutionary force is about what functions perform in saying something. This is like related to speech act. You could use the language for warning or making a request, apologizing, complaining, and complimenting. And the prolocutionary effect is related to the effect of utterance on the hearer. So if hearer or listener can recognize the elocutionary force and do something for that interlocutor, we could say that there's the evidence of a prolocutionary effect. Okay, to help you better understand these different speech acts and then the Grice conversational maxim, let's take a quick look at this video clip that I found from my favorite comic show, We Bear Bears. So here is a panda is waiting for his buddy from his app called the like a buddy matching maker, whatever. So panda was looking for a friend who has the same similar common interest here. So let's take a look at this episode first.
Excuse me, are you Panda?
Huh? Yeah, that's me.
I'm Tom. May I sit?
Yeah, of course. Sit, please.
Thanks. It's nice to meet you.
Likewise.
This is a bit awkward.
Yeah, sorry. I've never done this before.
Me neither. So, what made you try Buddy Maker?
I just clicked on an ad. I don't know. I guess I just wanted to find someone like,
like you?
Yeah, exactly.
Cool. So, I saw you're into Korean dramas?
Yeah, I got into this show called My Sassy Heart!
I love that show!
Really?
Hey, you're back. It's me. You came in with your brothers the other day. You wanted my number, remember?
I'd like the tofu salad, please.
Oh, okay. One tofu salad. So, Panda, do you want my...
Are you a vegetarian?
Uh-huh. Wait, are you?
Yeah, and allergic to any kind of nuts.
I'm also a victim of nut allergies.
Really?
I don't believe it. Nobody knows the kind of suffering we go through.
I know. I was gonna get the tofu salad, too.
Dude, we should just share one.
Yeah, okay.
So, Panda, do you want my number?
Nah, just a salad, please.
Okay, one salad.
And please make sure there's no nuts in it. Thank you. Man, she's really pretty. Anyway, where were we?
I don't know, but we have a lot in common. I'm just so glad I met you.
Me too.
Okay, so from this video clip, what is the location or act of saying, do you want my number, by a waitress? So that's like literal meaning of saying, do you want my number, right? It's like kind of a yes, no questions. Do you want my phone number? Yes or no, right? But then what is elocutionary force performed by saying, do you want my number? It's like, do you still want to ask me out for a date, right? So this is not really about whether you want to know my phone number or not. The elocutionary force was like kind of a requesting or confirming. That's what elocutionary force was performed here. But interestingly, the panda did not respond to our question directly, kind of avoiding the questions, saying just salad, right? Because she was waitress, right? Taking the order, but she didn't really like interest about the getting an order from the customers. She's like, hey, do you want my number? But then Panda said, just salad, right? So what elocutionary force performed by saying just salad, not answering to the question, do my number? It's kind of a refusal, right? I don't need your number anymore. I'm not interested in you anymore because I much more enjoy talking to my buddy that just sort of met through the Buddy Maker app. Did the elocutionary force take place for her when Panda responded to her questions? Yeah, she seemed a little upset, right? And she turned around. So it looks like she understood, right? Which of Grice's conversational maxim has been flouted here? It's quality, quantity, relevance, and manner. So like I'm talking about this pair of conversation. Do you want my number? And Panda is responding, just salad. So please leave your answer in the chat box. It's kind of multiple choice questions, right? Is there quality, quantity, relevance, and manner? There we go. Yes, is it relevance, right? It's not relevant to her questions, to my number, right? Okay, so it looks like you have now good understanding of Grice's conversation maxims and the different speech act. Okay, now I'm gonna switch gear. So this is kind of a brief introduction to what we trying to measure in language assessment. These are like common construct we measure. We measure grammatical knowledge, textual knowledge, and then pragmatic knowledge. I'll talk a little bit more about how we could measure this pragmatic knowledge on next Sunday talk. But we often use like either role plays or pair or group oral task or discourse completion task. Those are three common measures of assessing these different pragmatic competence. Okay, now I'm gonna move on to stages of test development, but I think it's probably a good idea to stop here, take a little like 10 minute break so we could start at 11. Okay, so let's take a break and we'll restart at 11. Thank you. Hey, I'm back. So let's. Okay, so now let's talk about the different stages of test development. So the very first step is that you start with the design statement, which includes who your target test takers are, what the intended purpose of using these test scores are, and then some available resources should all be stated here. But that's called a design statement. So once you prepare the design statement, and then actually in the design statement, it should include the targeted construct you want to assess. Right. And then you have to specify what type of language and knowledge, skills, ability you want to measure, which should be relevant to the decisions you want to make. So once you decide on these two aspects, you move on to the task specifications, which include item or task specifications. So once you have this kind of blueprint that will guide each item and task creation, you have to pilot the tests. You have to try out. So based on the pilot test result, you either revise some problematic items or simply toss out that problematic items, and then you come up with some operationalized version of the final test. Actually, that's not the end of it, right? So you'll probably get the result data, and it'll give you some idea about whether you have still problematic items or some biased items and passages. And then based on those analysis, you might need to either tweak the design statements or even construct, right? So it is important to remember that these stages of test development is not linear. It's a circular, right? So all these aspects of a test development are influencing each other. Then there are three different situations for developing assessment tasks. The first one is in the middle one. The TLU task is used as assessment task itself. So the TLU stands for Target Language Use. Target language use is used at the assessment task itself. So in some cases, you could use the TLU task as it is, and then you just come up create the specific procedures for for observing performance in the TLU domain, and then how you create the record and create the rating rubrics. So for example, if you want to become the pilot, right, or air traffic controllers, then you could use those kind of aviation communication as a TLU task. All you have to do is just like simulate the original task, right? And then you just add some language specific criteria, right? So this is kind of example. If they're very specific TLU task is specified, then you could use that task as it is, just like as some linguistic oriented task and criteria. And the next one is probably more common. The TLU task needs to be modified for use as assessment task specifications. And then your job as a tester to modify TLU task in some specific ways. So you could identify some TLU task, but that TLU task need to be adjusted to be used as assessment purposes. So, for example, many universities in the US, they have their own oral exam for international graduate students who want to be international teaching assistant, right? And then their TLU task is quite varied. They could might teach the undergrad students in the lecture format, or they could just, facilitate the group discussions in a classroom. And they also need to talk to their undergrad students in their office hours. So their TLU task is quite varied, but your job as a tester could identify those important features of a TLU task and modify it for your testing conditions. Right? So this is like probably more common situations. You could use the TLU task, but you have to modify it to be used in the language testing context. And then the final situation is like, there is no specific TLU domain. This is possible when you wanna use your tests across different fields, just as a measure of overall global language proficiency. Then it's quite difficult to identify some TLU task. So then you just, you know, create tasks based on your understanding of a construct definitions and then framework models of second language communicative abilities. Okay, so now this more details about the components that you need to include for your test specifications. This is from the Davis and Lynch 2002, the books. You have some general descriptions, you know, this kind of layout, the construct you want to measure, and then you need to describe what prompts and input the students will encounter. And then you need to describe how students respond to prompt and process the input. And then for helping the test writers to create more items, you provide the sample items they can model after. And then the fifth component, this is not necessary, is optional. If you think that they need a more supplementary information, so you could specify the information here too. So this is an example. So the general descriptions, you could say students will be able to summarize and analyze academic text. And then you provide more information about the prompt or input. So you specify the text length and then the text type, and then how the text is organized. And then this is a description of their response attributes. So what they need to do after they process and they need to respond to the text. And this is, you can provide the sample items here. So this is the two constructs you want to measure, whether they can summarize and analyze academic context. And you could actually, I didn't put the actual passages here, but you could provide after passages, after this title, and this example questions. So they, in this original passage, there are five different paragraphs, and that they have to match each paragraph to these key idea here. And then this example is an example of measuring whether they can summarize academic text. And then this is an example of how it could measure whether students can analyze the given academic context, like such as hula dancing underline, what does problem mean? So to answer these questions, they should be able to analyze the text and make some inference about the meaning of it. Okay, so that's kind of give you some basic knowledge about what you need to include when you need to design the task specifications and item specifications. Now let's take a quick look at these becoming most popular English tests in the US. It's called the Duolingo English Test. So what's unique about these Duolingo tests is first of all, it's cheaper. Right? You just pay like, you used to pay $49, but it's, you know, inflations, they increase the price now at 65, but it's much cheaper than other language proficiency tests like TOEFL and IELTS. And then you can take this test at home. So they use the remote proctoring systems. So once you can identify your identity through video chatting, you could take this test some kind of secure place where the strong internet connectivity is ensured. And then you could get this test result quite fast because all the responses scored by machines, right? So that's another unique feature of these Duolingo tests. But this test receive a lot of criticism for many different reasons. So I want to go through this demo of this dual English test. I want to ask you these three questions listed in the next to the video clip here. So I want to think about what construct do you think that this test is measure? And how would you characterize the input and response format used under this dual English test? What's your overall impressions based on this like quick overview of this test in terms of strength and weaknesses? So I appreciate if you can, you know, leave your response in the chat box here. So let's take a quick look at this test demo.
Word one, Murrefit. 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 Word two, influential. 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 Word three, lawn. 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 Word four, arject. 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 Word five, logical. 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 Word six, generation. 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 Word seven, excess. 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 Word eight, pastry. 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 Word nine, stimulate. 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 type the statement that you hear. I've spent way too much time thinking about this problem. I've spent way too much time thinking about this problem. I've spent way too much time thinking about this problem.
Right, so that's kind of a brief demo of this dual English test. So let's take a quick look at the answers first. So this is like a real English word in the list. And then,
you can look up
here, and this is the answer. The real English word in the list, indoors, unanimous, counseling, tyranny, adequate. Okay. And then this is the answer and the missing letters. So since the corresponding Roman date in the inscription is 24th January, this must be according to the incorrect calendar, which in 9 BC Augustus had ordered to be corrected by the omission of the leap days. And then the correct statement that they pronounced was, I've spent way too much time thinking about this problem. So this is the correct statement. This is dictation task. Okay, so based on your own observations of this demo during this test, please share your thoughts on each question. What construct? How to characterize input response format? What is your overall impressions? One thing we could notice right away is that their task is not based on any kind of specific TLU task, right? Because these tests like IELTS or TOEFL or Pearson test, it's not based on specific TLU domain. So it should be based on some kind of theory in language knowledge, abilities, and skills, and the models of SLA. So here, constructs like Shada received some her comments on that issue. So the construct is more like, I mean, if you just use the framework of a community language abilities proposed by Bachman and Palmer, you'll probably say is most likely grammatical knowledge with the focus on so language vocabulary knowledge in kind of decontextualized format, right? You just focus on the form, the meaning, the word form. It doesn't even measure the meaning of the word, right? So probably, yeah, it's like I would say the word recognition in both oral and written form. And then the C test we just saw would be like, so the combination between like reading skill and then vocabulary and some level of a cohesion, right? So the construct they're measuring is pretty limited. Regarding the input and response format, the input is like not usually at the text level, usually at the word level or sentence level. And then we have some very short passage level for C test. So the pros and cons of this one, many people criticize the dual language tests for lacking the authenticity in the test. This doesn't really reflect that kind of a language demands students will encounter in the academic context, right? So actually in response to these criticisms, they add a more interactive reading and listening test and extended response format. So students had to write according to the prompt. But compared to IELTS and TOEFL test, their input is too short and lacks some academic vocabulary. And then response format is still like eliciting very short responses. Yeah, and then regarding the strengthness, yes, it's an adaptive test. And it is scored by machine. And also items and content are generated by ChatGPT advanced model. So their items or passages are not really created by humans. They're created by generative AI. It's like ChatGPT 4.0. So in terms of the efficiency, right, it has a great advantage. And so the students can actually respond to the questions that are tailored to their ability levels. So they could save time, and then the accuracy will increase, but they compromise some like authenticity and validity of the test, which is very critical, I think. Okay. And now we're going to move on to some basic statistics, which we need to analyze your data once you have a data point. So in your test report, you have to report the central tendency, which is like basic, which indicate the typical behavior of a group. So you always need to report the mean, which is the common indicator of central tendency. You know how to calculate the average, right? And then we also need to report the median as well, which kind of divides score 50-50. So median can be interpreted as a middle score. And the mode is we can understand as the most common score. So in your score distributions, the peak or the hump of a score, it's identical to the mode. What about the dispersion? So this is about, tell you about how your score, scattered, spread around, and then range can be easily computed by knowing that the maximum and minimum, right? So the difference, maximum minimum difference is the range. You can also identify high and low, maximum minimum scores. But the most common dispersion indicator is a standard deviations. Right, so standard deviation is kind of average all the differences from the mean. So the word deviation is difference between each score and the mean, right? The reason why you put the standard before deviation, because it's the average deviations. So standard deviation is the same as average deviations. The reason why we use standard deviation over other like dispersion indicators like range is less affected by outliers. The simple formula for standard deviation, right? So if you know deviation and you square them, add up all the square value and divide it by sample size. So this will give you a average of square differences, and you take a square root, it'll become standard deviations. So simply variance is like the square average. That's the variance. Let's take a quick look at how to calculate standard deviation by hand to help us to better understand how to understand standard deviation conceptually. So we have a 10 test taker, they're given score, their mean, and this fourth column is a deviation, right? So difference is the difference between each given score and the mean. And you could actually get the average of difference by add up all this value and simply divide it by 10, which is the sample size of this data. But the problem is, if you want to add up all these difference value, you'll get zero, because that's the nature of the average mean here. So to get around that problem, you square each difference, right? 60 point times 60.2, 4 point times 4.2. And then you add up all these square differences, which will give you 91.6. And if you divide by the number of the test takers, you will get the variance. So the variance is simply the average of square difference. That's the variance, right? But this one is not an original scale. So to bring this variance value into original scale, you take the square root. So you get 3.03. So how do you understand the standard deviation of 3? It'll give you the idea that each score on average is different by mean about 3. So that's what standard deviation is about. Just note that we don't have really good standard deviation value or low standard deviation value. This is just like describe your level of a difference from one score to another scores. So, yeah. But if you think about if your test is norm reference testing, you may expect that really large standard deviations, because your goal is to spread out students as much as possible. But if you use some kind of a criterion reference testing before apt instructions, you expect that low standard deviation, because students kind of expect it to be more homogeneous, right, before and after instructions. And the next one is like, is important to know how to display your data. So this is a histogram. So it just tells you the frequency of each band of scores. And if you have a categorical variables like this, then use a bar plot. And then you could use this kind of the box plots, especially if you have different groups and they have a different... We have questions here. Notice that some people unmute themselves. Okay, now we'll just go on. This is going to be last slide of descriptive statistics. So you may see this box plot. This is quite useful when you want to compare different groups together. So in these box plots, you see that the box here that indicate that 50% of a whole distribution. So in the box, you see the bottom line that will correspond to the 25th percentile. And then top one would be 75th percentile. And then you'll have a whisker that extended from the 75th percentile. And then this whisker extended from the 25th percentile. And you see the outliers here that will indicate the score beyond that the whisker point. And then the line drawn within the box is the median, not the mean. So please note that the line drawn inside the box is a median, not the mean. Mean is not indicated in the box plot. So to help you to better understand this box plot, I prepared some of these hypothetical small data set here. So here we have data from 2 to 11. You know that this red color 7 is a median, middle number, right? So it will be noted by the line drawn inside the box. And then we have a green color number 6 and 8. So that's a middle number in the bottom fifth. And an 8 is the middle number from the upper half. So that's actually correspond to 75th and 25th percentile. So 8 is here and 6 is here. And then you want to draw these whisker, right? So to determine the length of the whisker, what you do is we need to calculate the first of all interquartile range, is called the IQR, simply the length of this box. So that's what IQR is. So Let me just quickly. Yeah, as you probably noticed in the chat box, so the IQR stands for interquartile range, which is the length of the box here. So in this case, example is 8 minus 6, 2. 2 is the IQR, the length of this box. And then if you multiply by 1.5, it'll give you the length of the whisker. So the whisker length will be 3, right? So plus minus 3 from the top. The bottom of the box. So if you add a 3 from these top 75th percentile, which is 8, you will get 11. So we have 11 here. So you could draw the whisker from the top of the box to the point 11. And you also want to draw the whisker at the bottom. So if you 6 minus 3 will give you 3, but we don't have a 3 here in this data set, so we cannot draw whisker here. Instead, we have a 2, which is beyond this, the whisker length, which will be outlier. So this is what box plot looks like if you draw a box plot using this small data set here. So this middle number is 7, median, and then the top bottom here, I mean, not, I'm sorry, not top bottom, the top in the box, which is the 8, 75th percentile, and 6 is here, which indicate the 25th percentile, and this difference is 2, and that will give you the IQR range, which is 3, right, and this is 11, and then we have a 2, which is outlier here, right? So this is how you actually understand the box plot. Okay. So this is all about simple descriptive statistics. You have to report mean and median, and you have to also show that the figures of your score distribution. And then let me, for the next probably like 15 minutes, let's quickly go through the correlations, which is the foundation of understanding the item statistics, and then to establish reliability, validity. So the correlation is a simple, but is the foundational statistics to do all the necessary statistics for your data analysis. So the very first step when you do correlations, you have to come up with the scatter plot. So the scatter plot is the two-dimensional graph where it indicates the two values from each variable. And then you could actually draw scatter plots from these frequency table here, right? So we have a 10 test takers, and then we have a two variables, that's X and Y. And each scatter plot indicate that the point from the same test taker on from both variables here. So by looking at the shape of the scatter plot, you could tell the strength and the direction of relationship between two variables. So here, this one indicates that really strong positive relationship between two variables. This is weak, this is strong but negative, weak, negative, no relationship. So if you take a look at the scatter plot, you could actually estimate the direction and strength of relationship between two variables. But, you know, just saying like, you know, strong, negative, positive is not really precise, right? So that's why we need to compute the correlation coefficients. And it's ranged from 0 to 1. The close to 1 is the strong, and the close to 0 is negative here. So here, if your correlation coefficient value fall between 0.7 and 1, you could say strong. Between 0.5 and 0.69, we say moderate. And the weak is a range from 0.3 to 0.0. But this is not really absolute criteria. So some people would say, like, if it's 0.6 above is considered strong, and then fall between 0.4 to 60. 60 will be moderate, and then below 0.3 will consider the weak, or 0.2 below consider weak. But it's kind of ruled down here. One thing that I want to kind of, I don't want to go through whole details of the correlations, but one thing that you have to remember is that we use a different correlation coefficients depending on the characteristics of your data. So one assumptions we have to check is that each variable should be independent of each other, right? If it's dependent of each other, your observed correlation coefficients will be overestimated. So, for example, I'll give you some example of two variables that are not independent of each other. If you want to look at the correlation between the total test scores and then reading subsection score, if the total test score includes the reading subsection score, these two variables are not independent of each other, right? There must be some autocorrelation between these two variables because total test score includes the reading subsection score. So if that happens, you tend to overestimate the relationship between the total score and the reading subsection score. So what did you do to avoid that independence problems? You could deduct total score from the reading scores, right? So your total score would be like sum of all the other subset score minus reading scores. Then you could deal with these independence problems. And then normal distribution, you scores, both scores should be normally distributed. So you could avoid some kind of either underestimating the true relations between two variables. And then it should be linear relationship, right? If you cannot find the linear relationship, your correlation coefficient would be misleading. And then if you want to run the Pearson correlations, you have to make sure that your variables are all measured at the interval scale. So I will talk about what are the some potential problems with the correlation analysis. The first one is a range restrictions, right? So sometimes we want to know how these two variables related, but if one of the variables has some range restriction problems, right? Then, yeah, your observed correlations may not indicate the true relation between two variables. So it's possible that you have either ceiling effect or floor effect from one of the variables. Then we are likely to underestimate the correlation between two variables. The classic example is the GPA, and then the college entrance exam is SAT in the United States. So this first figure indicate that the relation between two variable in the whole possible range. But in the real case,
เราเริ่มไม่รู้เรื่องแล้วก็แก
I mute them all. So, yeah, I did. I did. Okay, so here, yeah, so this is example when the one of the variable has a score restriction problem. So if your students are at the really top tier university, their SAT score range is pretty limited, right? And then but you still have a full range of a GPA, right? So then you may argue that, you know, SAT has a very poor predictive power, but you have to take into account that you don't have a full range from SAT scores. So how do you avoid this range restriction problems? You have to check the scatter plots. And if you see that this kind of a serious range restrictions, you have to report some special correlation coefficients to account for these range restriction problems. And then skewness is like when one of the variables is not really normally distributed, they'll affect the relationship between two variables. So you have to check the scatter plots. And then relationship cannot be always linear. It could be curvilinear like this, like anxiety versus performance, right? So at a certain level, anxiety can be positively correlated with the test performance. But if the test anxiety is too high, it will negatively relate to the test performance, right? So you have to be careful if you have a curvilinear relationship like this. And when you have like outliers like this, your correlations may be lower than expected. So if you have some questionable outliers, you may want to take them out, which will affect your the overall correlation coefficients. So those kind of problems can be easily checked by looking at the scatter plot. So it's very important to check your correlation coefficient numbers and scatter plots together. So just do not simply report the correlation coefficients. You have to look at the scatter plot and report it as necessary. And the final points that I want to say about the correlation, this is probably I would think that's the most important about the correlations, is correlations does not imply causations. So you will have a really high correlation between two variables, not because they have some kind of causal relationship, because the high correlation between two variables may be related to what is called the lurking variable, which is like real variable that is account for the high correlation between two variables. My classic example that I always use to explain this about the high correlation between children's shoe size and their intelligence scores, IQ scores. There will be a high correlation between shoe size and the IQ, right? But so should we like try to extend our children's foot size to make them smarter? No, right? What is the lurking variable, third variable responsible for high correlation between two variables? It's the age, right? So age is actually a responsible variable that explains the high correlation between two variables. So we should not take the correlations interpretations too far, right? Because correlation does not always imply causation. And another point that I always make about these correlations, we have to be concerned about the Simpson's paradox. So Simpson's paradox referring to some disturbing observations that the relationship between two variables can be reversed by adding another variable. So there's some kind of interesting correlations between whether students smoke or not, and then their academic performance in high school. So you may expect that there is like really negative correlation between these two variables, right? Whether they smoke or not. If they smoke, they may have, you know, performed poorly in academic context. But surprisingly, there is a positive correlation between smoking and then their academic performance, right? That's really surprising. Should we encourage them to smoke? Of course not, right? But what they found was that when they adjust for age, so they add an age variable, the relationship between two variables become negative. If they smoke, their GPA will drop, right? So that's another reason why you shouldn't, you know, make a, you know, jump to the conclusions by saying some kind of causal relationship between these two variables. We should always be aware of the possible lurking variable that explains the relationship between these two variables. Okay, so, right. And then I want to talk not much about this, but one thing they have to remember that when you want to do some item analysis for norm reference testing and criterion reference testing, you have to use different item statistics depending on which type of tests you are using. So if your test is a norm reference testing, which focus on the percentile scores to assess their overall proficiency, you need to report, you know, the classic item statistics like item difficulties and item discrimination, right? So item difficulty is simply about how many students get the item correct. That's what item difficulty, right? And then for item discriminations, index is ranged from -1 to +1. The closer to one, the more discriminative the item is. And then we usually report the item discriminations using the correlation between each item score and then total score, right? So I think that most of people know that, but if your test is a criterion reference testing, you can use these classic item difficulties and item discrimination index. So let me give you an example. So we use either report the difference index or B index. So difference index is like we compare the item difficulties between pre and post test, right? But this index is rarely used because we have to administer test twice, and it's more related to some kind of instruction related value. So we often report the B index. So for those who are not familiar with the B index, I'll give you more information about the B index. So what we do in the B index, we, let me give the actual data here. So first step is we need to determine on the cut points. We determine the cut points. And then, oops. We calculate the item difficulty from those students who passed the test. And then we calculate the item difficulty from those who fail on the test, right? And then we get the difference. That is the B index, right? So in the criterion reference testing, we classify students in kind of a different way, in a way that we classify students in the norm reference testing. In norm reference testing, we just divide the students into high, low based on their total scores, right? But when you calculate the B index, we divide students into two groups based on the cut points, and we calculate the difference between item difficulty between these two groups. And then let's take a look at these five B index value. Which item do you think is the highest discriminative power? Item four. Item four is 0.86, which is the highest B index value. So when you look at the item four, all the students who passed the whole test scored correct on this item four, but only one student from the failing group got the item correct, right? And then let's take a look at the lowest discriminative power, which is item three. And then it has a negative value, -0.3, right? So when you look at the actual item scores, you notice that more students from the failing group got the item correct than students from the passing group, right? So B index will give you that the which item has the more discriminative power between students who passed the test and that failed the test, right? So just please be careful when you report the item statistics for criterion reference testings. just don't simply report the item discrimination value. Just report the B index if you have a cuss course is involved in your test. Okay, so I think it's a good idea to just like stop here. Just keep talking would not be really good idea. So I will stop here now, and then I'll open up the floor for any questions you may have about what I talked about so far, or I'll welcome any other language assessment related questions here. So on the next Sunday, I will talk about what are the, some current trends in language assessment research and practices, with a focus on my own research that I publish in the many other journals and book chapters. And I'll talk about some, what are the, you know, the futures in the language assessments in the this generative AI era too. Okay. So while I'm waiting for your questions, I will actually just jump to the one important slide that I want to briefly talk about, which is, right. So this one is like, I think the most important slide from today's, my talk. So this is from the, you know, the Kane, the really famous psychometrics. This kind of a really provides a big picture about understanding the validity and reliability all together. So, you know, to validate our test, right, you have to specify what claims you make. So the first step is, as you can see here, domain definition, tailored domain. So based on our analysis of target language use domain using some kind of a needs analysis or task analysis, we observe our students' specific target behaviors, right? So the first step is we have to define our target language use domain. And the next step is called the evaluations. So this link is about we convert our observations to observed scores, right? So according to Kane, this link is called the evaluations. So this is like by looking at the reliability, we could tell that whether our evaluation is appropriate or not. So if you produce like consistent scores again and again across different observations, we can claim that our observed scores is a consistent reflection of our observation. And the next link is called the generalization. This link is often missed in many language testing validations. So what we do here is like relationship between observed score and universal score. This is related to the one of the limitations that I mentioned, which is like incompleteness, right? So we have a limited items, limited passages. So we are not quite sure whether our observed score is a good representative or all the possible scores students can get from the much more items and tasks. And that's about the generalizations, right? So these kind of evidence can be achieved by looking at the G study result, which will tell you whether you have optimum number of items or raters, right? And the next step is explanation. So this one is about the construct validity. Are you measuring what we want to measure, right? So if you have a sufficient number of the items and passages, And then can you say, argue that your test score is a good indicator of what you're trying to measure? And then evidence would be like, could be criterion related evidence, like whether your test scores can be highly correlate the similar measures of the same construct, right? Or if students are believed to be a higher construct can perform better on these tests than students who are believed to have a low level of a construct. So that could be considered evidence for explanations. And the next step is extrapolations, right? Whether the construct you measure is related to the target score, which is like they're like, the scores in the target language use domain. So that's where the assessing pragmatics is important, because in the real world, pragmatic knowledge matters, right? But if you do not measure your pragmatic knowledge in your test, your level of extrapolation will be lower, right? You don't have really good evidence for extrapolation. And then the final step is utilization, which is related to some kind of the positive washback and positive consequences. So even though your test scores is close to target score, but if you test for like making some decisions not really relevant to the decisions, I mean the consequences you want to bring about, right? So then you don't really have a good evidence for utilizations, and then the tests will not really bring about some positive consequences to test takers and other test users. So this is kind of, you know, the one big picture about the different links in interpretive arguments in the Keynes, the validation model. Just note that we need a different evidence to support our different level of the claims in this the link in this interpretive argument. Okay, so I will just stop here. Now I will welcome any questions and comments you may have here. Okay, so here one question from Phil. I will just read out questions for other attendees. Most teachers agree that teaching the culture of native speaking countries is a valuable, but how much should this be done? Do you have a percentage in mind or other way of saying how much of the course should be about the culture? Okay, so yeah, so we definitely need to teach culture, right? That's like directly relevant to the social pragmatic knowledge I was talking about. But, you know, the thing is, different parts of the countries has their own unique culture as well. And then we teach English as an international language. So, right, there's so many different cultures that we need to cover. So if you just focus on the one specific culture, like for example, America, but what about students who want to study in UK or Australia, which might have a different social pragmatic norms, right? So one thing that we have to be careful about when you teach like social cultural issues, and then we have to probably teach like some kind of a universal social pragmatic issues, not really too culture specific, in certain can be applied to very specific countries or parts of the countries. So it is important to teach like focus on more kind of a universal like politeness in, you know, social pragmatic knowledge. And then if you teach like very some content specific, like if you teach like business English, or if you teach aviation English or medical English, in that specific context, we could actually pinpoint very specific like social pragmatic norms and then cultures. You could identify those issues. Then we could implement those cultures into our ESP courses. So it's My answer to the question is, like, depends on what course you teach, whether you teach English as international language, or if you teach English for very specific content or context, right? And then one comment about the understanding reliability. Yes, reliability is not about whether your test is reliable, it's more about the consistency of the test scores. So the reliability is not the quality of the test itself, it's the quality of the consistency of test scores themselves. World English is a better than focusing. Yes, right. Yes. So we're not really focused on the native speakers' culture. And another point that I will also bring about next Sunday is that even among the native speakers, they have a large variations in their responses in the kind of a pragmatics items. So a lot of pragmatics researchers identify some kind of answer keys, right? Because even among the native speakers, they respond differently in the same context. So what is the target like responses we're looking for? Even we see the large variation among the native speakers. So I remember that one of my colleagues, Catherine Bartleby-Hollick, she had a really hard time identify the convention expressions spoken by native speakers. So she actually had to use only 50% percentage agreement among the native speakers. So if native speakers agree on the more than 50%, she identify as a target convention expressions. But that means that about 49% of students, I mean, the native speaker use different convention expressions, right? So she received a lot of criticism that her cut point at 50 is too low. So I think that her, like, some more recent research, she increased the cut points from 50 to 75. But still, you know, there are a lot of variations among even native speakers too. And then another question from Jun. Could you please clarify how can we ensure that internal consistency of the pre-post test? Okay, so I mean, we could easily check the internal consistency by reporting the Chromebus alpha, right? You can check the, you know, you could run the statistics and then identify Chromebus alpha as an indicator of internal consistency. So you have to report internal consistency of pre-test, post-test separately, right? So yeah, you have to report internal consistency of pre-post-test separately here. We don't really concern about consistency between pre- and post-test results. We have to report consistency from pre-post-test separately. Okay, any other questions? Yeah, I don't see any questions yet, but you know, if you have any further questions, please feel free to email me, or you could ask me next Sunday as well. So stay tuned. We'll see each other next Sunday. So, thank you for your attending my talk today. See you next Sunday. Oh, hang on. One more questions before I wrap up my talk today. Any tips, strategies to work with the Generation Z in the language classroom? So this is not really testing questions. So Generation G, probably like my own kids. There, I think they belong to Generation Z. Language classrooms. I would say that we have to use really authentic materials in the language classrooms. Like, the thing is, our Generation Z students have exposed to, like, you know, TikToks videos and YouTube videos and Instagrams or whatever. So they know what authentic language use is. I mean, they also watch like Netflix too, right? So they have a better idea what you know, genuine language look like. And if you use some kind of very like outdated language and materials and activities, and that will definitely demotivate students in our language classrooms. So we have to be careful. And you know, the language changes very rapidly, right? So we have to, you know, always monitor whether we use really updated materials and activities to make sure that they're all engaged well in the classrooms. Yeah. Okay, then yes, I will just wrap up my talk today and then we'll see each other next Sunday. So, kop makap, and then, yeah, thank you.
Okay, so thank you again for those who are online and also on site. And we are looking forward to meeting all of you again next Sunday. We have two more talks from Dr. Shin. So stay tuned and have a great day.